Hey guys, so this is continuing on with the art of communism number 5. And really, I know I spent 3 videos, about more than 30 minutes, responding to the comments or even the videos this week. So that was pretty awesome. Thank you for watching my videos. Thank you for so many comments, so many interesting comments, even the ones that are hateful and even the ones I consider stupid. I'm going to be honest, some of them I do consider them to be stupid, but some of them I consider to be pretty brilliant and honest. But anyway, whatever kind of category your comments fits in, thank you. I do enjoy the fact that I get comments on my videos, and I always enjoy engaging in discussions or even debates with you guys. It's really interesting to learn of what you guys think. I just think it's fun, and it's pretty cool that I get to take part in that. So thanks for all the comments. If I didn't highlight your comments in this hour of communism, that doesn't mean I didn't like your comments. Just please understand that. It just means that there were so many comments I received, I had to pick and choose which ones I wanted to highlight. And then those are the ones that were the most interesting and the ones that engaged me the most. So if I had the time and if I had the energy, I would, you know, and if you were actually not going to be incredibly bored by that, I would highlight every single comment I get on my videos. But it seems to be the case that I'm now receiving much more comments than I usually do. So that's great. So that's that. Yeah, so thanks for the comments. Keep them coming. I always appreciate them, even the ones that are hateful towards me or especially the ones that disagree. I expect criticism, and I actually welcome criticism. So that's always great. I also welcome positive feedback too. I mean, I love those like any other person would. So great. Thanks a lot, guys. Now let's move on to an actual talking point. And this is kind of, I don't know if it's actually like a single topic, but in American politics last week, it was a mess. It was a mess of, like people say, you know, there were a lot of scandals. I don't know if I want to consider them as scandals, but certainly the White House did a lot of things that were fucked up last week. And it's just, you know, the thing I allude to most is when The Daily Show, you know, with Jon Stewart, when The Daily Show hits a certain level of comedic gold, you know, when The Daily Show is so freaking hilarious, that's when you know that this country is in dire shit. The correlation is negative. You know, the funnier The Daily Show is, the worse shit the country is. Not necessarily true, but it certainly feels that way sometimes, because this week's Daily Show was just hilarious. But it just made me realize, shit, there's a lot of shit going on in the government right now, and it's pretty crazy. So, I mean, the Republicans are trying to get President Obama impeached on the whole Benghazi thing. So that's been going on since actually like since a long time ago. It's just been revived. That whole debacle has been revived 2 weeks ago. While that's going on is when the whole fucking IRS thing comes up. And it turns out that IRS has actually been targeting specific political groups that have names that sound, you know, that kind of include terms such as patriotic, freedom-loving, liberty, which are usually political groups that are right-wing and usually Tea Party political groups. So that's extremely problematic considering how ILS is supposed to be not partisan. And targeting those groups definitely was partisan. So, scandalous! So that happened. And then, of course, there's this whole thing about, you know, the White House administration demanding personal records and private information from AP news sources and kind of snatching that. It's just an ugly picture of what's kind of going on in the government right now. And it makes it seem like this might be the least transparent executive administration that we've ever had. Maybe worse than Nixon administration, which we all know crumbled because of the Watergate scandal. And ironic considering how President Obama's administration was elected on the hope and the promise that this will be the most transparent government, which definitely has not been the case. But this probably should have been expected considering how, you know, President Obama is a brilliant politician. He plays the game of politics brilliantly. And in some sense, that's great, but in other sense, that's terrifying. Because we have situations where government can be pretty damn sneaky. This reminds me of a time when, and it was recent, I think it was last year, or if I'm wrong, it might have been 2 years ago, but either 2011 or 2012. I think it was more 2011. But the 2011, December 31st, 2011, on going to January 1st, 2012. This day in history, Congress and the Obama administration approved NDAA, which I don't personally know what it stands for. I think it's like National Defense Authorization Act. I'm not sure if that abbreviation is correct, but they passed that under our noses. December 31st and on going to January 1st. Why? Because everybody's celebrating New Year's Eve and New Year's Day. They were too, enjoying their festivities and too wrapped up in their own private affairs to actually have to care about what was going on in the White House and in Congress. And what they passed was NDAA, which grants the executive branch the power to detain any U.S. citizen if they determine that U.S. citizen to be a national security threat. Yeah, that happened under our noses. Secretly, this is the kind of administration we're talking about. This is terrifying. They're so good at their political game that they can just dupe the public like this. And I think I watched a conservative YouTube blog, which talks about the fact that Obama still has an approval rating of 50% and usually higher, which is pretty high considering that the previous administration, Bush administration, could not keep their approval rating higher than like 34%. That was like their highest. Like, it would usually be way, way lower than that. Pretty interesting to consider. When a president is really good at playing politics, on the one hand, it can be really good because the president is a smart president. If the president knows what he's doing and if he's working for the good of the people, then things get done the way he would want them to be done. But power corrupts. That's a thing to generally accept as being true everywhere, whether in America or the United Kingdom or Japan. Power corrupts, and the most powerful person in the world is President Obama, and because he's such a smart person, power corrupts. You know, and his administration is definitely corrupt, and things have come to the current status quo of the United States government is a really problematic one. Especially considering, I think one of the most damaging things that happened to this country was the Citizens United case, in which now corporations are considered as people. Corporations have personhood, according to that Supreme Court ruling. So corporations are now considered people, and what that means is they are entitled to First Amendment rights. So they're entitled to freedom of speech, freedom of press, and all that, which is why they have the ability to send unlimited amount of money to politicians of their choice. That's what happened with that ruling. So money in politics has become so, now corporations are really controlling politics behind the scenes. And that's become so much the case that really, like, it's a really problematic, troubling situation currently in the United States government. So it really doesn't surprise me that this administration is being this way. I think it would be this way no matter who the president is, honestly, with how state things are. If Romney became president, things would probably be worse or similar. I don't think it would be the same. I mean, I don't think it would be much better for the people as a whole. I'll end this video on this note, this part of the video anyway, this part of our communism, on the note that Ralph Nader made, and he made this point like in 2003 in his book, when he talked about how he ran for the presidency as a third party candidate, and his point was, when the two parties are so similar to each other in how, not in their ideologies, but in how they are impacted by corporations that back them, and these corporations don't have, you know, they don't have political sides. Their bottom line is to make as much profit as possible, whether that be by pulling in Republicans or by pulling in Democrats. It doesn't matter. Profit is the bottom line for these corporations. When the two parties are so influenced by corporations, it doesn't matter how different their ideologies are. It doesn't matter if Gore got elected or Bush got elected. We need a presidential party that is not tied down to moneyed interests. And that's why Ralph Nader was running. And that's why Ralph Nader pretty much said, you know, his point was, his point ultimately was that he didn't cost the election, you know, it wasn't because of him that Bush won the election. You could argue that, but further on, even if he concedes that point, even if Bush won because of Nader, which, if you read this book, or if you just, you know, look at the results of the election, it's kind of an argument that I don't agree with, that Ralph Nader was why Bush won. But even if I concede to that, it wouldn't have meant that much difference if Gore got elected. It would still be this mess of two-party systems. I think Nader, on one hand, actually argues that it's better that Bush won. The reason is because Bush is the more stupid president. Like I said, when you have a smart president who knows how to play the game, it's terrifying because he knows how to play the game. Bush definitely didn't know how to play the game, so every action that he did, the media blasted him for it. Really blasted him for it. Like his approval rating went down, people were angry, everyone, he still duped a lot of people into doing things the way he wanted it to be done, probably with the help of Cheney. But, yeah, when you have a dumb president like President Bush, people react against it. And therefore, there is a better movement among people. When you have a smart president, and the president knows how to play the game of politics, and he's playing the game against his constituents, then it's possible that we end up like this, in this situation where the government is the most least transparent than it's ever been, where things are happening without even us knowing about it, and we're being duped into thinking that this country is going the right way, or we're doing the right thing on certain things, whereas actually the only people winning are corporations because they're not considered people. What the fuck? So that's really, I feel like a pessimist in talking about American politics at this point, but it really, the past 4 years or so, it's been really crazy, and this is ironic coming from me, considering that I personally helped Obama win. I personally went out and got out the vote for President Obama, which is probably another video altogether. But it's oh man. Like I said, like Daily Show was really funny this week, and that gives a good sign of what American politics were like this week.